Today, since the context of the symposium is about architecture, and architecture is one of my, I think, main inspiration in life, I try to make this presentation in three chapters and try to cover in 40 minutes. And again, I'm currently teaching at UCLA Design Media Arts Department, where I got my second MFA degree. And you can reach my works from the webpage, because Zoom will not be very exciting to share video files and experiences, but you are very welcome to join and see them in a proper frame per second experience. And you are, I'm happy to get your messages and questions. So today I'm trying to explain my humble journey in three chapters: early findings, how I found architecture as a canvas, and why I found things that were inspiring, and then founding the studio where I am joining right now to this event from Los Angeles, California. And then the lastly, mission intelligence and its context and discourse in the work that I will be sharing. I'm originally from Istanbul, Turkey. I think one of the best in the world that I think was truly inspired by the potential of the urban design. And then, as we all know, city itself is holding centuries old culture and sometimes extremely undesigned. And I sometimes felt very connected, sometimes very disconnected, because not the culture, but the design problems. I think I'm very obsessed by the minimal and the super grid and more thoughtful, I think, design and textures and materials. But I think the city was in a different fabric. And then I also found a very maybe cliche start, but I was 8 years old. My mom was constantly bringing home random video cassettes. And this movie specifically was one of my hero imagination experience that allowed me to understand the urban space for Near Future Los Angeles 2019 November that Ridley Scott was depicting with his team. And the same year, I got my first computer, which was Commodore 128, and start playing games. And I've been playing games so long and very obsessed with the games. I think I was addicted kind of till the beginning of my undergrad studies. What was really inspiring is not just a machine that you can collaborate, but I think the games were creating an architectural connection that is much inspiring, much exciting than my home, my room, or the city itself. And I found much excited when I was in the mind of a machine, or somehow like reconstructing the imagination. My early studies are very focused on the architectural photography. And thanks to the Istanbul Bilgi University, I have been very fortunate to work with one of the most inspiring photographers in architectural field, especially head of our department, Ihsan Derman, who is, I think, a pioneer in the visual communication design field for people who don't know. And also Orhan Cemçetin was my also second hero photographer, also a mentor. And then I also learned a lot during my studies, undergrad studies. Because of my scholarship, I have to work with a team. And for the scholarship, I have to babysit an exhibition with my colleagues and learn how to install 300 media art projects inside a building in Istanbul called Central Istanbul. And during these visits, what was very inspiring is this event. Because of my visit to ZKM in Karlsruhe in Germany, I was able to witness some of the most inspiring talks about the media facades and media architecture. And I think what this event truly changed my mind was a beautiful speech from Lev Manovich. And he was saying, in other words, architects along with artists can take the next logical step to consider the invisible space of electronic data flows as substance rather than just as void, something that needs a structure, a politics, and a poetics. I think what I am doing, and today I'll be showing, is exactly pretty much aligned with the vision of wonderful mind of Lev Manovich. And I started to use light as a material 2009. And I was very obsessed with not just the art itself, but the contextualization of space. And when we think about space in the painting, we should not just think about two-dimensional pigmentation of ideas. And if you look at the like early Renaissance, or like even 1874, Pere Picasso and his friends' criticism about the space in paintings. But specifically, I think I was much more inspired by how geniusly architects were commissioning spaces to enhance the third dimension in their built environments. And simply get inspired from all this, and with Elcan Aktürk, we created a project 2009 in Central Istanbul, and created the first audiovisual performance using architecture as a canvas, which is Emre Arolat's wonderful building in Istanbul. And this beautiful minimal surface became a canvas. And this is the year I witnessed that actually the architecture can become a canvas, and when it's used purposefully and it becomes a public canvas public surface, that can open up a whole new imagination. and pretty much, I think those are the days when the videos became viral easily, not like this level of like Facebook, Instagram, or certain social networks. And this video reached many, many people, including the Ars Electronica curators in Linz, Austria, and then did many projects, including Sana'a's wonderful building in Essenwald in Germany, where we were able to cluster, I mean, basically plot their original idea versus what will happen in the future of architecture that cannot hold a space. I think I was much inspired while all doing that. Of course, it became a very, very repeatable action, but early 2010, these ideas really resonate very well. And then also, I think the most, for me at least, open-minded process was a project called Augmented Structures in collaboration with Alper Derimboas. And this project was a beautiful call from Yapı Kredi Cultural Center. And thanks to Tülay Güngen, who is the director of the institution, very openly and generously asked for what will be like a dream project. And I was truly inspired by it and then thought, what will happen if a public art piece truly hears the public space, not only just the visual, but also sound, and create its own form and create a communication. But it was like a very, I mean, challenging 3 weeks of project, or maybe 2 months, but 3 weeks of heavy hands-on project. And we were able to cluster, use 3 days of sound recordings of the street and transformed into a three-dimensional surface and then augmented by light, like a living surface in a three-dimensional data sculpture, I'm calling it. But around those, what was very inspiring for me was like not the idea of data, but the data can become a space. And if you think about data as a living entity, a kind of a language that can go beyond what its purpose is, then a new imagination starts to open up. And by the way, I was very obsessed with Perlin noise specifically. And since last 10 years, I never stopped imagining that by Ken Perlin. This is the 4-6 line of code I memorize. And coming back to like the still idea of a frame, by the way, very funny, this frame idea obsession 2011, I tried to like convince the institution, but it was so expensive to put a massive 40 meter long, like a canvas around the building anyway. But the idea was coming from that time, like 2010 and trying to like 2011, it didn't happen. But at the end, we have like a surface that is augmented by light. The sound coming.
Yes, perfectly coming.
While the project was a really challenging several weeks of doing things in quickly, but I also find that actually the true inspiration is not only architecture, actually it comes from the science fiction, because the more I remember like the origins of the ideas, I found that actually there are many heroes in the game, like William Gibson, Philip K. Dick. I don't know if you read Neuromancer, but it's one of the probably most inspiring book that I personally enjoyed. But I think, as he said, this world between digital and real and the physical and virtual became much more inspiring for me around 2011. And then what I also very inspired is not only just the architecture, but also cultural context and how actually our lives are very transforming into this new kind of reality that I don't think we have so much control. And I think the control is meaning like not only just the machine and human interaction, but truly our decisions, and especially in the recent context of machine intelligence, like our context with machines becoming much interesting. But from an architectural point of view, I think how we perceive space and pretty much hard to distinguish if we are in the mind of a machine or if we are in the space where the thing is shared from, or like are we in a physical world. So that kind of like disconnection became much more inspiring. A sense of kind of displacement became more also inspiration. And then also, if you know the art as a context, how the information flows and how a young mind can get the data in probably a couple of minutes from a Wikipedia, it becomes like question time and space at the same time. And I always think that the art should not belong to a museum and gallery. It's such a boring idea and such a 21st century idea that you open a door and behind that door there's art. I don't think it was inspiring. And especially doing my early public art projects like 2009 Quadrature, 2010, 11, and all these projects, I found that actually it's design and art together, because as John Maeda says, design is a solution to a problem. Art is a question to a problem. And I found that maybe the best question that fits to this is, honestly, what does it really mean to be a human in 21st century? And I think this question truly inspired me, and also inspired me the idea of a connection between humans, machines, and environments, and simply to collide them in a physical and virtual context became a true inspiration. So coming back to the same image that I think I showed you before, the Blade Runner, and that specific image became my like staple, and then decided to join UCLA Design Media Arts Department 2012, and then start a new journey with my mentors, Casey Rias, Christian Moller, Jennifer Steinkamp, Rebecca Mendez, wonderful minds in the field of public art, computational imagination, and also during that visits, I met with Tom Main, Greg Lin, Frank Gehry, and many others. But when I come to Los Angeles, I wasn't in a studio like any artist. I was on the streets. I found myself doing projects all over the Los Angeles, augmenting surfaces. But one thing that really inspired me, Le Corbusier, as he explained in Modelor 1, architecture is judged by eyes that see, by the head that turns, and the legs that walk. Architecture is not a synchronic phenomenon, but a successive one made up of pictures adding themselves one to the other, following each other in time and space like music. I think this specific statement truly one of the reasons I inspired by Frank Gehry's Disney Hall. I will explain more about that, but I will just come back to that. The idea was 2012 when I came to the project, and I was inspired by the building and the context of the LA Philharmonic home and Frank Gehry's cultural beacon. But I was also inspired by the idea of what will happen this building can one day dream. Like, can it remember? Can it like learn? This cognitive capacity of a human, can it be applied to your built environments? So, and these questions I was able to ask on the stage in Microsoft Research, and with my short, I am showing this a lot because I wasn't aware I am next to Bill Gates, who is later became my also collector. And then the next days of this award, which is a Best Vision Award, the idea of augmenting architecture with cognitive imagination. When the award came, and then later the Frank Gehry shared his files, I was able to graduate 2014 with Frank Gehry's original 3D files as a case study. And then humbly, LA Philharmonic invited to do a project inside the Disney Hall by using existing surface of the concert hall and heavily inspired from 1958 Fleet's Pavilion, where Corbusier and Varese was collaborating. And back in time, 2014, inspired by the body motion of the conductor, SFX Solonen's body motions truly attached to the building's surface. And I was truly able to augment the surface of the building using Frank Gehry's original polygons. They became a canvas. But the thing that I think inspired me more is what will happen if a conductor can both conduct the time and space. the really interesting part was not just like, you know, I think this is the interesting part. The idea didn't fit inside the building, and Frank Gehry didn't design the building or the team by, I think, predicting one day large projectors may come in. And I think this is one of the first, I think, white hacking of architecture, being able to embed media into the architecture in a way that doesn't belong to it. But still, but I mean, we were very lucky to work with Disney team and other teams at LA Philharmonic, and were able to like put these giant projectors into the sound booth and try to augment the building. And for me, the big stress was Frank Gehry, not the technology, because he's a hero. And behind the scenes, I know him that he is not always very positive, and he is against authenticity. He loves authenticity, and he really hates things are gimmicky. He hates things are not connected with the ideas. But the good news, he was in the green room, and he was there for supporting Trulli and saying that, for sure, it was the first time he saw that a Trulli embedding media arts concept was working. And he enjoyed the piece, but also said that to the CEO of LA Phil, that we don't need this boring screen anymore. That white screen that goes up, down, and shows you the projection is such an, I mean, don't want to say the words, but such a limited idea. So it was a very good, I think, feeling, because when you hear these notes, the feeling is very positive. I mean, hearing from your hero, something that you made really purposeful. And then we opened our studio 2014. And right now we are a group of people. We are AI engineers, data scientists, architects, designers, anthropologues, storytellers, and scholars and researchers. And a really diverse group of people. We can speak 12 languages. We are, our median age is 25. And it's pretty interesting to be think together. So I'm not alone here today with you, so sharing the projects. And I think what is also inspiring today to talk about is like, I've been working with many leaders in the tech giants, but also like from the Gansler, SOM, Arup, and schools that have been like changing the academic like discourse. So today I'll be sharing some collaborations with those like also in inspiring people that is different than any other, I think, art studio. And I think today, one of the most inspiring topics is, as I said, like 2012, when I went to the UCLA with Casey Rias, the first question I asked, like, can data become a pigment? Like, can we use data as a mean of expression that is beyond just numbers? And of course, the data means for humanity is beyond like every single, like 2 day, 2 years, 3 years. We have an enormous amount of like process and recording of like our past. Our future is basically based on that. And I think what is also really, really problematic will be in just, I mean, 20 years, the humanity will be producing 3.5 global emissions, and within like 10 years in 14% of entire global emission will become of because our egocentric likes and shares and comments and things like that, or streams. So it's a very important question, I think. And also philosophically, I think as Kierkegaard says, life can only be understood backwards, but it must be life forwards. I think data is an exactly representation of this context. If you look at data to understand our past, can definitely talk about the forward too, our future too. 2014, I was very fortunate to be invited as an artist in San Francisco, and with SOM and also Arup was also as a designer colleagues in the team, was able to propose a data sculpture embedded into an architecture in three dimensions by using publicly available data from the city of San Francisco and transform them into a three-dimensional, basically a living organism, a data sculpture in an architectural scale. And it specifically followed the corner problem in architecture, try to find a way how to enhance a two-dimensional experience of a surface and go beyond that and try to find an idea that is driven by data from the city itself and have a connection with the built environment and the context of the architecture and connect that this disconnected and find a narrative inside that. This project in San Francisco truly changed our landscape, because when you make a project next to the like giants, Twitter, Facebook, I mean, you every single tech giant having a coffee right next to this building, it was a very changing Google or like, I mean, so what was really inspiring for me was one project changed all our like imagination, and suddenly we were in the dialogue between, I mean, the CEOs of those companies or like the people who are deciding the next big thing, SOM, Gansler, Arup, like we have been collaborating and like thinking together. And the whole idea was so simple, like, can data become a pigment? Like, can we reconstruct the data as a space? And I think that's like how we like, I think, enhance the imagination. And after 5 years, happy to say we are reconnecting with the piece and making a new one. Very soon you will be seeing. And later, I think what was really inspiring is not only that, we work with the systems that are bigger than us, such as flight networks. And there's a project in North Carolina, Charlotte, and we were able to use every single data point from a flight network of airport and then transform them into a three-dimensional data sculptures, changing every day based on the data. And right now there is no pattern. As we all know, the COVID is extremely stopping the data points that they were coming a year ago. It's one of the most, I think, large scale installations that is really aligned to like people mover and make that boring time into like an experience that is almost 125 feet, very long distance experience. And then also we don't just do this, and also like I was very inspired by what else we can visualize in this universe. And especially inspired by like signals, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, LTE, 5G, like we are constantly looking for how we can use what space inhabits, how we can use this invisible space into a visible space, which opened in Auckland, a project called Sense of Place. And I couldn't share it because the COVID just stopped us documenting. But another, I think, exciting project finished visualizing the invisible patterns of the signals in the spaces. And then I think this project was very exciting to share, the idea of a data as a pigment. 2016, one of the collectors from Boston specifically asked, I want a painting that can move. And it was a competition. And there I found the idea, what will happen if we take wind as a data, environmental data of like temperature, wind direction, and like simply global flow of the invisible movement in the air, and transform this data into a pigment. And then that created wind data paintings. Start with Wind of Boston. And the idea was like to find the poetry inside the nature that we cannot reconstruct unless it's memory. But how we can use, technology or computation to feel. This series done in like many locations in Boston, Bali, Istanbul, London, New York, Los Angeles, Miami, and many at Seoul and many other places. And I think what was really inspiring is if you think about pigment as a kind of an entity, let's say an agency, and that can like carve a surface. And if you program the software in a way, you can create a new domain, a new space that always in flux, in change, like in life. So no offense to architecture, but I think architecture is sometimes very boring because it has to use the physical quality of life and the gravity. That means that your imagination is stuck in concrete, glass, or metal. Of course, the functions are incredibly important and there's a depth, but at the end, you're in the mercy of Newtonian imagination or Cartesian space. So I think what starts to be more inspiring is what happens if you go beyond that realm and try to find the new narratives. And that's why I found that water, which is, I don't think we can survive without two things, right? Water and the sun as a light. So I obsess with light as a material and water as like a movement that is, I think, visible in the systems. And then later on, even like focus on ideas such as like Bosphorus and Black Sea, which are visualizing the invisible patterns of signals. From the high radar frequencies, such as Black Sea, that visualizes what you are seeing is around 70 million line and data point cubes recorded from the Black Sea, thanks to the meteorology in Turkish meteorology system that allow us to like download enormous amount of data, around 40 gigabytes of radar frequency data. And we let AI to look at these patterns and reconstruct the surface of the sea. And then we basically plot this data back to the like system and create this ever-changing surface, which also inspired one of my hero, Jensen, the CEO of NVIDIA. And 2016 and 17, we were starting to like collaborate. And he's an incredible mind with an incredible team. And I think the support from NVIDIA, like Microsoft, like Google, changed our studio. I think we have been working with one of the most cutting-edge algorithms, and upcoming systems that have been like, I mean, basically we are working with ideas before they become products, if it makes sense. And this is really inspiring imagination. And also working with real-time graphics. And I think what really makes us, I mean, if you can see this, for example, 2 years ago, around this time, technology called RTX announced as a studio were the first system and reconstruct the light and shadow in reality, create this universe. That means now it's real time, that is ever changing. 2 years ago, we were able to be a pioneer in this light and shadow context of a space that can be ever changing without any interruption. And this was a really inspiring thing because that means all these data sculptures, all these data paintings are becoming real time, meaning they are changing with the signal, with the environment, which architecture is stuck in that physical quality. And now you can go beyond that, not the VR, AR thing that I'm talking about, the truly signal that comes to the system and reconstruct its own reality. And more interestingly, I guess, all our past projects, by the way, this is a software I'm using called the VVVV, lasts almost now more than 10 years. It's a visual programming language, and you can go to the www.org and you can directly download and learn and work. You don't need to need a single line of code. You can just work with this and create incredible concepts using data or, I mean, live captures of any inputs and work with parametric design elements. You can create like connections between your imagination and computation. And I think it's a beautiful software that changed my imagination. I hope you can have a look. It's kind of a grasshopper, kind of like node-based other softwares like Max MSP Jitter or like Blueprint in Unreal or like recent like VFX Graph in the Unity, but it's a very progressive and very, I mean, powerful system that you can create things. So pretty much everything I'm showing here today is mostly coming from VVV. And also very inspired by this idea of what will happen if you open your door in your room, that door opens to a dimension that doesn't exist. Inspired from Aldous Huxley's The Doors of Perception, and I created Infinity Room 2013 in collaboration with, by the way, Jennifer Steinkamp, one of my hero professor at UCLA. And I was asking her the same question, like, why do we need a ceiling and the floor? Why do we need a corner in architecture? And what will happen if this room reconstructed every single day by the machine randomness? Of course, inspired from the Kusama's, I mean, incredible infinity mirrored rooms, but I was not inspired by just static world. What will happen? This room reconstruct itself and it created infinity room. And the project started in Istanbul, Turkey, and then traveled 47 cities in the world. More than 2 million people explored and almost every continent except Antarctica. This project traveled all around the world. So the last part of the, I mean, if you are interested, happy to also talk about like this project, because now we have been interacting with the space, with EEG, I mean, heart rate, like monitoring ourselves, connecting our human inputs into the space, and many things we have been researching at UCLA also in my studio. And lastly, this last part of the presentation, I want to go to like the part where I talk about machine intelligence. 2015, July, if you remember this image, it's called one of the most probably inspiring Deep Dream. This is a kind of an algorithm that had been published by the friends at Google and in a blog post. And there was a research attempt to understand how actually machine learned and how it can be backpropagated and let the machine look at other things that it can create a context, let's say. And this means that like us, right? If you look at all the time, the human photos or human, like we can look at it, we can imagine someone's face, right? We can reconstruct a reality from like our own like a cognitive system. And similar idea, if the system like this trained by animals, and if you show something else to this system, it reconstructs everything based on what it learned. So this idea of inception, the idea of a dream concept, was incredible. But I was very fortunate because of our project in San Francisco that made a big impact, I guess. Google team, especially Blaise Aguirre-Arcas and Mike Taika, and also Memo Akten and Mario Klingemann, who are the very early experimental artists working with this code, invited to an event called Deep Dream. 2016, February, I think the AI art truly started. Because in this event, in this symposium, we discussed about the future of art, but I was the only one never use AI. And they said, perfect, that's a perfect reason we are inviting you to become artist in residence. But if you talk about AI, let's just be first serious about the technology, because I don't think it's just inspiring because of techno fetish context, right? So if you look at just 2017, like 17, and these are all the events have been triggered unethically, a problem of AI happened. And at the meantime, if you think about Google, for me at least, this machine called Google Glass was an epic disaster, because you remember these beautiful images, but the result was something like that. So technically, what is a dream of a product and how it like explored was a big problem. So this, if the same thing happens to AI, and if I become a part of it, I will be extremely, I mean, very upset and so sad and depressed. So I thought, no, that's not the direction I'm looking for with the AI, but I'm really inspired by, the Blade Runner, right? Because the same year, 2016, 17, if you remember, the Lilium was get the first approval that flying cars are coming. I mean, we know that Alexa like can have a 46 seconds of the world's fastest information. I mean, like Microsoft Cortana, like 8 language, like Siri. I mean, these all are going on. And 2017, people were speculating that the Facebook is like recording every single data, it's available. And I mean, we know that this is happening. And in the meantime, I mean, around those days, I don't know if you really remember that, but for me, DeepMind research was incredible. And AlphaGo, right? If you watch the documentation, I cried so much. I was really inspired with the idea of a machine and human can collaborate. And that human can enhance its power of imagination. But also what was inspiring me is the research inside the neuroscience. It was also getting much inspiring. And the researchers were trying to find a living beings, a material that can compute, which will be incredible for architecture, that is going beyond like light, or like neuroscientists can read literally brain activities almost like 11 seconds before we act. Like this is getting really interesting. Or like today, Elon Musk will be announcing for just $27 million, he can open a 2-inch hole and download and upload data. I mean, while all this going on, I thought like it's a time to think about AI with architecture. So today I am literally thinking about what will happen if AI, neuroscience, and architecture come together to make a new context. And that's a speculation about that. So archaic dreaming is the first attempt, the idea of using knowledge as a material and transform it into a space that can become only available in the mind of a machine. Thanks to Mike Taika, my very first mentor from Google, who trained me and my team how to use machine learning algorithms 4 years ago, 2016, and we became the pioneer in the field of machine intelligence and aesthetics. And again, the idea is how we can use machine to like create this very humble connection with the consciousness that information and knowledge and wisdom can be explored. Inspired from the Library of Babel, Jorge Luis Borges, we were able to create at SALT in Istanbul using 1.7 million documents into a built environment in three-dimensional immersive environment and transform this data by using image recognition algorithms and let the machine look at this pattern and then analyze them in a space called latent space. So I think my architect friends are always speculating this, that what will happen in the like the post, I mean, digital architecture. But I think as an artist, I think your problem should be latent space, because that's a space only exists in the mind of a machine. This space is only mathematically available and you cannot perceive. It is n dimensions. You cannot create a plan or section. I mean, the methods that architecture is holding is limited in here. So I thought that's perfect case study. So let's dive into that. So 4 years ago, I'm personally obsessed with the latent space, but I'm not sure what does mean for architecture. But I was obsessed with this algorithms called lower dimension reductions, which is basically take the n dimensional space in the mind of a machine. Imagine millions of like points of data that are clustered. And by using these algorithms, we were able to plot them in three dimensions and turn them into a three dimensional data universes. And imagine this is maybe the future of architecture. Imagine this as like a space you can inhabit. But I think what was really inspiring is when you put this data and witness and put a human in this library of the future, that when you witness how machine quickly learns and you just watch it as like a perfect place, this might like become very interesting. So anyway, archaic dreaming was one of those speculations that I think truly changed. At least from my perspective, the idea of knowledge, the idea of like architecture in a world where there is no like search bar or many others. I think the other big question is, there's an algorithm called DCGAN. In 2016, we were one of the first be able to use this algorithm to let the machine hallucinate 1.7 million documents of archival materials. And the question is, what will happen if one day AI creates almost realistic documents which cannot be perceived from or distinguished from real, and who will decide what is real? And I think from there, we know that now deepfakes are all the way. And as 4 years ago, there's no deepfakes. And as you may guess, that was a prediction. Or we also use these lower dimension reduction algorithms, like recently, let the machine to listen to music and cluster it in the form of like three-dimensional surface, and then augmented by the music of LA Philharmonic and LA Master Chorale by the beautiful Das Paradies Schumann. Augmentation of a three-dimensional form augmented by three projectors from different places by Einstein. People can from multiple perspectives can explore the same three-dimensional form by the music is interpreting new algorithms. And lastly, I think this topic that I think I couldn't forget, that 2017 when I visited Istanbul, I was very inspired with AI and like learning about all the potential of it. And then unfortunately I arrived in Istanbul and learned that my uncle was unfortunately in the stage one Alzheimer's. And I think it was a very I'm calling it beautifully dangerous feeling, when that's for sure our memories, something we cannot hold on to or we cannot like touch them, but that's for sure they're our most precious data points in life. And I was listening there with Eagleman's amazing talk, like he was saying, this brain is not hardware, not software, it's a liveware. But how we can touch this liveware that we can really know and understand the moment of remembering? So I wasn't obsessed with what the memory is. I wasn't obsessed with like what that people is thinking or imagining or remembering. But the idea was, can we at least turn the moment of remembering into like a sculpture, a representation? So thanks to the friends and the wonderful minds at UCSF, University of California, San Francisco, Adam Gezeli's lab, NeuroEscape, they trained me and my team how to use EEG devices and look at the pattern of remembering. And then with a large amount of memory recordings, we were able to use AI to look off the pattern of remembering as like a domain of like signal and extracted it, and then create a custom software, 2017, and reconstruct these memories into the form of like noise sculptures. If you remember like my obsession with Ken Perlin, like 2009, that I was like remembering those algorithms. So we were able to create our own noise algorithms driven by this EEG data that is ever changing, and then capture this in the form of a media wall and transform it into an exhibition called Melting Memories. So what you are seeing is a moment of remembering, a 4 milliseconds, 4 minutes. Some people think that kind of an architectural scale wall, a wall remembering that will like remembering like what we our memories. I think speculation perspective one of the most inspiring things, I think, is remember us. The architecture will eventually become cognitive brain. And I think this was kind of that speculation that what will happen, memory becomes a substance in the near future that can explored by these mediums. And then I think the last part of this talk is, I think, about, I mean, as Carl Sagan says, imagination will often carry us to the worlds that never were, but without it, we go nowhere. So I thought that the next step should be, if we can reconstruct a memory in the forms of signals, can a machine truly hallucinate? 2017, I guess, right after the Archive Dreaming and NVIDIA collaborations, I was very aware of their journey. And again, algorithms invented by Ian Goodfellow and DCGAN research in 2016, I thought we should go beyond that. And inspired from this research, Ian Goodfellow's and many others in the GAN field created mission hallucinations. And the first thing I did was not just go to my, like, I mean, other egocentric things, but I said, like, what will happen if we look at the architecture from the perspective of machine's intelligence? Meaning, what will happen if you look at Renaissance, contemporary, Baroque, or like deconstructive? What will happen if AI can look at these patterns of space and then reconstruct them? So basically the question is like, can we use collective memories of space to create the collective dreams of spaces? And then eventually, just for people who doesn't know this, maybe specifically, when you train a neural network, you need to like find a way to navigate. And the navigation in latent space is one of the biggest challenges. So with NVIDIA's and internal our research, we create a custom software that allow us to fly in the mind of a machine in latent space, in n dimensions, and reconstruct the spaces that only exist in the mind of a machine. These are not random plottings. These are not like random, just like bunch of points. They are purposefully merged from facade to interior to exterior to like door to like wall to ceiling to floor. Like that kind of reconstruction of space is one of the like dream behind that. And to make it happen, I'm currently like researching with the Gerys and Zaha Hadids and Tadao Amdos or like Libenskins, like kind of all the heroes I have been researching and finding the patterns in their work. And also working with NASA GPL, looking off also spaces that we cannot go, right? I mean, Mars, red planet, maybe our next home. And the question is, what will happen if we use the machines that are looking for our memories, I mean, our future, such as Mars, Hubble, and ISS? So these three missions are research, and we are trying to reconstruct the latent space in three dimensions, not in two dimensions, and trying to find an architectural context in the space of a mind that is beyond just two dimensions or three dimensions. So this research is going on and you are very welcome to look at them in our webpage and happy to explain or talk about this. Now it's almost 4 years of research and I think it inspired many people like how to use AI and then reconstruct the space and how to like use really machine learning algorithms and really understand this world. And this is ISS data. And also recently we are working with the cities. Starting in 2018, we were able to work with New York, Berlin, Stockholm, and Seoul. We research, for example, for New York, download 113 million images of New York and reconstruct the reality in the form of immersive room, which I am calling synesthetic architecture. An architecture that has a sense of space, sense of feelings, sense of emotions, and cognitive skills, such as can learn, remember, and even dream. So this kind of a new speculation method that I think the project done in Arthouse, New York, called the Mission Hallucination, explored a kind of a latent space in the form of a machine that is connected to a space is reconstructing these data sets in the form of moving images. But architecturally, an AI narrating architecture, collecting the neuroscience, an AI and architecture. Hallucination concept. The music you are hearing is not real as well. They're all machine hallucinations. And also in recently in Berlin, we reconstruct the Kraftwerk, which is an incredibly 6 years old power plant, or actually six years old power plant. And we were able to create three-dimensional neural networks that are used in image recognition in three dimensions by using lasers and animate, but also real-time track the people in the space and their location, where they look, how long they look, became an inspiration for AI and reconstruct the AI's Berlin dream based on the audience reaction. Some people think it's an AI church. Some people think it's a cyberpunk post-apocalyptic architecture. Some people think something else. But what was really inspiring is when you take over an existing building and reconstruct the narrative on it, the architecture becomes an incredible canvas. And we get some really significant positive reaction of this kind of a Tate modern reaction that I think happened to Olafur Eliasson. And I think that was a really inspiring research that is going on right now in our studio. The other pioneering project was, I think, lastly, I want to finish with this project, which you remember 2014. As a student, I was trying to make this happen, but unfortunately, 2014, LA Phil was not ready. Frank Gehry was not ready. The idea was not purposeful enough. And then 2018 and 19, which is last year, was LA Phil's 100th year anniversary. And they invited again to say, what will happen if we collaborate? And I said, perfect, because now I can use AI, because 6 years ago I was aware of it, but I couldn't. And then I challenged them, what will happen if we take our entire data sets, the raw materials of LA Philharmonic, which was around 44 terabytes, but when you process data, it became 77 terabytes of incredible archives. So imagine every single data point a building can hold, like the recordings of audio, like images and video files, like pretty much anything you can find in the archive of an institution that represents 100 years of like memories. And the question is, what will happen if we take the existing architecture of the building, which is, as you know, the Disney Hall is one of the most compound curvature, reflective surface, like it's not an easy surface to work with. But with our team and the Gehry Technologies and the Frank Gehry and the LA Philharmonic, we were able to create 13 unique locations by using 42 projectors. We were able to reconstruct the building in three dimensions and reproject it back to itself. So it's not a projection mapping we know, like 2D penetration of a surface. It's truly taking the building and truly putting it back to its own space, if it makes sense. So to make it happen, we couldn't use the original CATIA model. We need to reconstruct the 3D model of the building. So we literally by hand reconstruct the building in three dimensions. And then basically like look at every single necessary and unnecessary parts, and then reconstruct the surfaces, materials, textures, and even the substructure of the building that you cannot see. So like seeing through the building, like cutting fMRI of the building, at MRI of the building was the idea in some certain cases. And we touch every single data points from the 100 years, every single decisions of the institution, concerts, like artists, like conductors, the music they choose, or like even like, I mean, the question, what will happen if AI goes to a concert? What will it see? What will it feel? What will it understand from this 100 years of data? Like, will it give a context to like the body motions of the conductor and many other things? And then by using machine learning algorithms, we were able to get these data sets and turn them into a pigment and then basically project it back to the building as a mean of like pigment. And like the memory of the institution were becoming a pigment, a kind of a material that is becoming a part of the architecture, if it makes sense. And then to make it happen, it was a Google Arts and Culture collaboration, and also Parag Mittal helped us really deep dive into these archives and look at every single machine learning algorithms that have been not used in the architecture before. And then it became like canvas. And I think what is really very inspiring also, not just image, not just video, we also look for the audio. The institution have an incredible amount of like audio recordings, like starting from 1928. So 80 years of, I mean, normally maybe 90 years of like incredible data. And what you see here is a measuring algorithm looking for every single audio recordings in 10 seconds of points. And every single point you see here representing the past. And the question is, what happens if you click a button and reconstruct the Mahler, the Beethoven's, I mean, anything that exists in the archive and reconstruct it again? So lots of research in machine learning algorithms, pigmentation of the memories. And lastly, I think the big question is, if one day a building decides to decide and thinks that, do I need to look like this? Like, can architecture one day speculate its own context of space and how it will do that? Will it look like the first thing? I mean, if I'm a building that have a consciousness, I will probably first go and see how the buildings is perceived from the audience. So we went online and scrap every single Disney Hall photos available we can find. Then, so NVIDIA's PGN algorithm, we train a neural network of every single photos we could find online and let the building look at its own context. The music you are hearing is not real, but also like reconstruction. And create a three-dimensional sculptural context and let the building truly dream based on what the people want. And who knows what it might sound, but this is speculation. And that was like the last part. The finale is like projection back to the GAN algorithm to the building, and the result was something like that. And if you want to watch it, it's online in YouTube, but I don't want to like, maybe, like, let's watch it now then and take your questions. this was the last part of the performance called dream part. And I think what is really inspiring is like not just only like imagining the future of architecture, but truly collaborating with the architect and its vision. And I also learned that during this research, Frank Gehry was looking for a similar idea for many years, and his idea rejected. And his idea was projection somehow lights, not in this context, but he was extremely happy. And he was saying, oh, another thing that after 2014, this time again, he was surprised and giving a wonderful feedbacks. So currently we are working with many institutions and especially in the United Nations and understanding the patterns of data and life. So hopefully share more, but thank you very much for listening and ready for questions and more inputs. Thank you. And sorry for it taking a little bit longer than expected, but I hope it was meaningful. Thank you.